Are you good?
Yeah, pretty good. Yeah. Thank you. Okay, thanks, Ronnie. I'm going to, jeg snakker norsk og så videre, men bedt om å holde dette på engelsk, fordi vi har en del utenlandske gjester her. Jeg håper det går bra, men jeg tar imot spørsmål på norsk også, så det går helt fint. As Roddy said, I came to Norway in 1981. I was part of the Green Wave in the UK in the 1970s, and I was a vegetarian. And as he said, it was almost as though vegetables were illegal here in Norway. What I didn't know was the Sami people; they were big vegetable eaters, but that was a secret as well. Just to survive, I had to start to growing vegetables. I'll tell you a little bit about the background for where I am today at the beginning of the talk, and then I'll go in and talk about a few plants. The title of the talk, Veterinary Arctiska Permagrönsaker, what I mean by permagrönsaker, the perma veggies, is permanent vegetables, perennial vegetables. Most of the vegetables we harvest from nature, we forage in the springtime, are perennials. Many of the traditional vegetables, like cabbage, was originally a perennial plant. I'll just tell you something about the first picture we see here. It's an onion from North America. It's North America's most common onion, widespread onion. It's found right from the Arctic to actually almost down into Florida. It's a beautiful onion. It's actually grown as an ornamental in some gardens in Norway. I love the combination of edible and ornamental. I call it edimental. It's my word, or prudsaker in Norwegian, prudgrønnsaker. This onion here was very important food plant for the Native Americans. It was also a very important food plant for the European settlers when they came to North America. They learned from the Native Americans, and this was real survival food when they were traveling westwards. It's not a bulb onion like we're used to in the shops. It was the green parts that were mainly used. I also call it Chicago onion because the city of Chicago, the name Chicago in Native American actually means onion, because Chicago was built on the prairie where this species of onion was very, very, very common. Nodding onion, prairie lurk in Norwegian. My slides are actually in Norwegian. I kept it that way because to get a good balance here, so you can read, and I'll kind of translate into English as we go along. And the background for this talk, I've given this talk quite a few times, maybe about 25 times this summer in various parts of Europe and also in Canada, is that I have a book coming out in October, which is called Around the World in 80 Plants. I actually have a little information about it. You can send it around. The talk I normally give lasts from 3 to 5 hours. 45 minutes, I've had to limit it quite severely and concentrated on the theme of this particular conference, which is Arctic vegetables. And what I've done over the last years is to get inspiration from foraging traditions around the world to find new vegetables which in many cases can be grown here in the northern areas, including the Sami traditions. So it's quite nice that you gave a nice introduction there to this. And the book basically is a kind of a travel log where I take the reader on a journey around the world and visit various parts of the world where my 80 favorite perennial vegetables, which I grow in my garden in Malvik, just outside of Trondheim, come from, all the stories behind those plants. The stories often are just as exciting as the taste and the et cetera for me. Okay. Also, when I came to Norway in 1981, despite the fact there were no vegetables in the supermarkets, I quickly got to know about the Nutevekstforeningen, now called the SOP or Nutevekstforbund, or in English, the Norwegian Useful Plant Society, which is actually quite a unique society on a world basis. I know no other country that has a society which is dedicated to useful plants. And I quite quickly got to know this guy here, Jan-Erik Kofod, who started up a local group of the Nutevekstforening in Trondheim the same year that I moved to Norway. And I very quickly started going out on foraging tours with them in the springtime and learned that just outside of my house in Malvik, there were something like 60 different edible plants, particularly along the shoreline where the diversity is greatest. In addition, we have all the seaweeds, which are used widely in other parts of the world. And so this was a big inspiration. And so not all of these 60 were good to eat. Some of them were awful, but were real survival food. But many were actually very good. As explained, I'm actually an oceanographer who work with the sea. And in connection with the job, I've traveled around the world. During my travels, I've bought books on local foraging around the world and discovered new plants. And then on one of the trips, I found this book here, Struthervant's Edible Plants of the World, which had a very short description of about 3,000 different botanical species which were used traditionally for food around the world. Wow, I thought, this is really interesting. At the same time, I'd had kids. I didn't have so much time to go out foraging, so I started moving some of the local plants into my garden. I didn't realize at the time, but what I was actually doing was what native people have always done. They've moved their favorite plants into the gardens, and because it's nearer to the kitchen. Some of those plants have gone on to be commercial plants. Others have just stayed very locally, local food. And there are many examples of that. Can't talk too much about this, and then I also found this book here, Cornucopia 2, which is my Bible. I've just come back from Ottawa in Canada, and my bag went missing, and my copy of Cornucopia 2 was in that bag. I feel naked without it. And as you see, I've worn out one copy. Luckily, I got a new copy from Amazon last year. It's not so easy to find. I think we'll just go on from that. This is my garden in Malvik. This is my vegetable garden. Doesn't really look like a vegetable garden, I think, but over the years, I've collected more and more edible plants. I'm actually a sick man. I have collectomania. My father, he collected stamps. I had to find something, it became edible plants. So today I have a collection of about 2,000 different edibles from around the world in my garden. And many are actually quite many you would recognize as ornamental plants in Norway. And then from the fact, so I'm all about diversity, extreme diversity, if you like. I became known a few years ago as the extreme salad man because I started making these very diverse salads. I made a world record in 2003 with 538 different edible plants. All these salads you see here, which I've made in connection with very mock festival in Trondheim, etc., have over 120 different edible plants. Now, most of us, we don't use more than about 30 in the whole year. So in one taste of my salad, you get a lifetime of plants. Anyway, and they're rather beautiful too. Yeah, I mentioned earlier on that I'm talking about perennial vegetables, and actually some of the, many of the traditional vegetables that we grow in our gardens, like cabbages and beetroot, Swiss chard, etc., and also pura or leek, were originally all perennial plants. So the wild species that they derived from were perennial. And even up to about 100 years ago, there were many types of perennial kale which were cultivated in Europe. But the perenniality of the plant was there all the time. It didn't really fit with modern agriculture and ploughing and all this. So many of them died out. But some of them survived locally in gardens around Europe. In particular, for example, the Daubenton's kale from France is still cultivated. There's a tree collard from North America, and there are three or four other ones which have survived up to today, thanks to local garden owners who saw these vegetables as really useful. These can be hundreds of years old. You propagate them by taking cuttings. Just set the cutting in the earth and they'll set roots. And as I say, also beetroot, wild beetroot, as a salad green is beginning to become popular again. And also there are a number of wild perennial leeks available. There's maybe about 20 different types of perennial leek out there in the world. I've just made a quick list of advantages with these, what I call permagrantsanker or perma-veggies. First of all, the growing perennial vegetables complements the traditional vegetables in that we harvest them in the springtime. One thing, at least in my case, in my garden, is that none of the perennial vegetables are damaged at all by insects or fungi or anything like that. So it's much easier to grow them organically. You don't have to sow and plant every year. This is much more climate friendly. There's quite a lot of interest today actually in also in perennial grains, because we know in the future we will have much less, we won't have the oil we have today. So we're looking, there are research teams looking at perennial wheats and perennial rye, etc. And the same with vegetables. So it's much more climate neutral. Many of the species I use grow best in shady conditions, actually, in places where you wouldn't think of growing a traditional vegetable. I'll show you some examples of that. As I mentioned before, many of the plants double as ornamentals, and this concept of edimentals. In the springtime, there's no problem with drought, normally, although we had a drought in Trinidad last winter. But generally, there's no problem with water, because after a long winter and snow and snow melt, there's plenty of water in the soil. There's less need for fertilizer, in that the perennial vegetables, their roots go much deeper and are much more effective at bringing up available nutrients. I mentioned here this with drying and lacto-fermentation, which are techniques which the Sami people used. And you have to find, if you're harvesting your vegetables in the springtime, you have to find ways of conserving them. And one of the ways is by fermentation or lacto-fermentation, which has become very popular, particularly amongst youngsters in Norway today. There are courses being held by the Nytøveksforening and around the country. And it's also seen as a very healthy way of eating food, the fermentation process. The last one here, I just point out that these perennial vegetables, I believe particularly, are useful in cold climates, in Arctic areas, in mountain areas in Norway, because the perennials, they come very quickly into growth in the springtime, and they optimize the available solar energy, which is there over the whole season. Whereas traditional vegetables, they take a long time before they get to a reasonable size, and where the roots are getting effective in bringing up the nutrients. And undoubtedly, in my garden, which can be classified as sub-Arctic, perhaps, if this is Arctic, then it's the perennial vegetables which give the best yield, no doubt about it, compared to the traditional ones. And they're perfect as well. Okay. I actually have a couple of slides on salmi vegetables, and I'm sure you recognize some of these. We've already talked about some of these just now. We have sorrel, Engsyre, and which was a very important vegetable, often grew in large quantities where the reindeer were kept. It likes to be fertilized by the reindeer muck. So this is a very important vegetable, and there is particularly one if you're growing in the garden. This one here, which never flowers, and gives a much larger food, a larger yield than the wild plants, which very quickly flower. And so this one you can actually take leaves throughout the summer. You've mentioned the mountain sorrel, or fjellsyre, which for me is an even more tasty sorrel. I have quite a big area in my garden devoted to that one. And we have kvarn, or angelica, which is also a fantastic vegetable, quite productive, and also a vegetable which the Norwegian people used and almost managed to eliminate from nature by over-harvesting in the past, because it was the flower stem that was used, and when they cut the flower stem, then the plant would usually die. And we have in Norway a particularly interesting one, which is grown in the Voss area in southwest Norway, called Vossekvarn, which is different to the standard kvarn in that the stem is almost solid. There's very little hole in the middle, so it's much more food value in this particular valley. And you can also use the leaf stems on that particular plant. Other plants which the Sami people used were storklokke, giant bellflower, which is a very productive, all plants in the klokke family, Campanula, have been used around the world for food. And in fact, we have a tradition from Trøndelag, written down in the 16th century, that farmers around Trondheim, they collected large amounts of this plant from nature. It's a plant which grows in woodland, quite dark conditions around Trondheim and western Norway. And they used it for soups in the springtime. This is a tradition which died out sometime after that, but we have at least one record of the Norwegians using this. The Sami people, they actually moved this plant. I'm talking about the South Sir Sami people. They actually moved this plant to where they lived and planted it in woodlands. We see that from the distribution of the plant. It grows on the western Norway and then some locations where the Sami people were active, particularly Snorse in Nord-Trøndelag. So actually the Sami people were the first forest gardeners. Forest gardening has become very popular, particularly amongst people interested in permaculture. If you've heard of that, I won't go into detail, I don't have time for that, but within permaculture, perennial vegetables has become very, very popular. And it's also a beautiful plant when it flowers in summertime. And then we have this very bitter herb, turret, which we've also talked about, the Alpine South Thistle, which is interesting also in a garden sense, both as an ornamental. This is the flower, which is rather beautiful, a bit like chicory flowers. But it's also a very large plant and very productive plant. So with some selection work, I think you could manage to develop types of alpine of turret which are milder tasting, because it is quite a strong taste. And I think the fermentation process actually also reduces the bitterness of the plant. And then finally, we have the Alpine Bistort or Harerig, which has also saved people's lives in the past, also Norwegians, in that those that knew that the roots of the Harerig were edible, they managed to survive the winter in bad years in the past. But bit that I use mainly are these small, what look like seeds, but are actually bulbils, which fall to the ground and set roots straight away. And they're really good, have a nutty taste, and it's also a rather beautiful plant. And I use the seeds, I dry them, and I use them on bread and other baked dishes in the wintertime. But also a very good trail snack when you're out in the mountains. And I believe that there should be an extra, you talk about a fjellregle, T-fjellregle, it should be an extra one. Know this plant, because if you know this plant in the mountains, you'll have a good chance of surviving some days. Now we've come to the Lofoten Islands. Can you give me 10 minutes, Roddy, wherever you are?
Yeah, I'm here. I have you. Don't worry.
Tell me when it's about 10 minutes left.
Yeah.
In the Lofoten Islands, we have a very interesting plant, which is it's actually not a native to Norway, but it grows in large amounts on the island of Vestvågøy. It's an onion, Seierslurk or Victory onion. It's like a large version of Romslurk or Ramsons. And it's been introduced at some time in the past. One doesn't know when it happened. One theory is that it was actually a Viking plant that was actually grown in Viking onion gardens at the time. When you visit this island, it's very easy to, there's just so much of it. It grows everywhere, and particularly on that island. And it's actually on that island we have the Borg Viking Museum and settlement. So it was a very important Viking place. So it's nice to think, we can't prove it, but it's nice to think that this onion, which grows in such large amounts here, is a Viking plant. But the plant itself is, I should say that people grow it as an ornamental up their driveways. In gardens. You talk to people and you tell them this is a fantastic edible plant, really, really tasty. They have no idea it's an onion, even. And when you tell them it's an onion, they say, well, is that why we get this kind of onion smell when we're clipping the grass? It's also a rather beautiful onion. This is actually Borg, where they've actually planted this onion into a reconstruction of a Viking onion garden. But it's a plant which grows, has a very wide geographical distribution, right from the Pyrenees and Alps through Europe to the Caucasus, through Siberia to Japan, and even in the Aleutian Islands, almost goes into North America as well. So it has a huge geographic distribution. In Japan, they grow it commercially in fields, actually, because it's often that people have moved into the large cities, and they remember their roots, and they ask for the food which they remember from when they were living in the countryside. And this is one of those that was collected from the wild and people loved. And some years ago, I was contacted by a Danish guy. I make a seed list every year to get more and more plants and trade seed. And I was in contact with a Danish guy who had had family in Siberia. And he told me that in Siberia they made a lacto-fermented dish using this onion, which was on the level of caviar. A few years later, I visited him. I sent him seed, and he grew this plant. 10 minutes, okay. I visited him, and I was able to taste this, which is it's mixed with creme fraiche. Yeah, we had a safari, onion safari to Lofoten, which I led this summer for the first time, which was great fun. Yeah, I think we go on. Rhubarb is actually a very hardy plant. We see it in the mountains, grown by the tourist huts. Very hardy plant, and originally it came to Europe, and it was a vegetable. I've got many recipes of where rhubarb was actually a vegetable. And where rhubarb originated, it was collected from nature and used as a vegetable. It's only when sugar became widely available that we started treating it as a kind of fruit. Welsh onion, pipelerc. This is an interesting onion, which actually comes from Siberia, but we find it on old turf roofs from the Gudbrandsdalen area, where it serves a double purpose of food in the springtime and fire protection, because the leaves are succulent. Luckily, some of these roofs are now protected by law and the onions themselves, and it's developed in this very harsh environment, very cold in winter and very warm in summer. So this is an onion which can be grown anywhere in Norway. Yeah, I think we'll pop over. Yeah, Carver, I can say a little bit about. Carver is the, as you know, the most common spice in Norway, because it grows more or less everywhere, from Lindesnes to Nordkapp. And yeah, we know it mostly as a spice, but it's also in the past been used as a vegetable, spring vegetable, and one traditionally made a soup, carver called super, from it. So I haven't got much time. It's interesting that also in the past it's actually been used as a root vegetable, which is very interesting for me, because this is a very hardy plant. It can tolerate everything we can throw at it in Norway. And it, this guy here in the 1850s, he actually selected carver as a root vegetable. I've started trying to copy him, and over just a few years I've found that I have quite a sizable root. Very tasty, slightly sweet tasting. A real potential, I think. But nobody else is doing this for us. You know, we have to. There are very few people working on vegetable breeding in Norway now. Yeah. Nettles, yeah, we know all about nettles. When we eat nettles in the springtime, which is the most common wild foraged plant, we're just part of a worldwide movement of nettle eaters, in that all cultures worldwide had a local nettle species. From Africa to Siberia. So just think of that. You're part of a global movement. Won't say too much about that. This is for example, what I call the death nettle from New Zealand. You don't want to mess with that, but it is actually edible with care. Similarly with dandelions. There are a whole range of fascinating dandelions across the world, different colours. These are all from my garden. This is a rose, pink dandelion, which I've found growing in quite a few gardens in Tromsø, actually, as an ornamental plant. There's a red-leaved dandelion, which is fantastic for spring salads, the colour contrast. And there are even white dandelions. There's one in Svalbard, for example, which has white flowers. Fascinating and really useful plants. Just run through these very quickly. In France, dandelions are sold on markets. I make dandy noodles, or lerva noodle, which are made from the flower stems. Fantastic, tasty food. Yeah. One of my favourite, most best-yielding perennial vegetables comes from the Caucasus, which is also very hardy, was introduced. It's what we call Caucasian spinach, or Hablitzia only. It's a climbing plant which grows in woodland, incredibly productive. On one root, I get something like 200 shoots every springtime on a plant which is 10 years old. And each shoot is about that long. It was originally introduced to Scandinavia in the 1870s as an ornamental, and after some time this is a plant which is in closely related to Meldestock, which we saw, those who were on the tour earlier, or fat hen, I think it's called in English. But it's a perennial, whereas Melda Stock is annual. But after some time, people discovered that it was quite a good, it tasted very good. It has a very mild taste, can be used as spinach, can be used in salads. Eventually, it became less popular as an ornamental, but some of the plants where they were originally planted have actually stayed there since the 1920s or something. And we had a project within Norway. I work partly for the Norwegian Genetic Resource Centre, Gen Research Centre. And we had a project where we have collected old Hablitzia from gardens around Scandinavia, mainly in Arctic areas in Finland, in Sweden, and one place in Vesterålen. There was one plant which had survived right up until about 10 years ago. So a fantastic plant to grow. Lerpsticker, lovage, you know, this very, very common plant in Norwegian gardens. The secret to get better yield is actually to cover with a big pot in the springtime. And you then get a much milder product. You can use more of it. It's like a spring celery. But unlike my autumn celeries, which are full of slugs and slug damage, these are perfect. In the Himalayas, we have, this is one of my favorite, I also call it Sherpa onion. We know the Sherpa people on Mount Everest, but they also had foraging traditions. And this is my favorite onion, which from there, very large onion, which they used mainly in lentil soup. Siberian, I'm just going quickly through these because I haven't got that much time. This is the Siberian onion, yeah. 5 minutes, yeah. Yeah, okay. And this is an interesting one, which on the previous one, this was given to me from a Siberian vegetable garden, perennial as well, quite broad-leaved plant and quite attractive. And then as part, I've worked on a project collecting old Norwegian vegetables, also for the Gen Research Centre in Norway. And there was this information about an onion which cropped up in gardens in northern Sweden, which has got the name Norlands lurk. It's a very large plant. It was being grown as an ornamental. Nobody knows where it came from. And to cut a long story short, we sent it for genetic analysis in Germany to an onion expert there. He reckoned this was a really good onion to grow for food. And he discovered that it was actually a hybrid between two Siberian species of onion. So this is a real heirloom Scandinavian onion. Then a quick tour into Japan, one of my favorite, or actually my most productive perennial vegetable is this plant, which we call Udo, or Aralia cordata. It belongs to the ginseng family and is sometimes used as an alternative to ginseng. But it's also a very important vegetable in the Far East. It's been reported to have survived temperatures down to minus 30 in Finland. These stalks on my largest plant, I get about 20 stalks, which are about 1 meter high in the springtime. I also cover with one of these large builder's buckets. And when the bucket starts lifting up, then it's ready, okay? And you basically just peel the stems, and it's used as a salad in the Far East with a dressing of sesame oil, roasted sesame seeds, and soy sauce. But one of the most amazing things about this plant that I discovered was that they have a very unusual form of gardening in Tokyo, where they have a special type of earth under the city, and they've built these huge caverns where they move the roots of this plant, and they force it in completely dark conditions to get this very special variant of Udo, which is has a milder and interesting taste. It's another guy under Tokyo. So this plant is really one of the best in my climate. This is me in front of it in the beginning of June. So it has an incredible growth in the springtime. It's growing on something like 15 centimetres of earth. And, well, people that tell me that perennial vegetables don't yield well, I just show them this picture because it's an amazing production. The other one, which many of you be familiar with from Japan, which is a favourite, is hosta. Many grow this as a garden vegetable. Also very, 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 very productive, and also can be grown more or less throughout Norway. It's the spring shoots which are used, which I call hostons, inspired by chicons, the chicory shoots, which we can buy as I think sometimes called julesalat in supermarkets. Very mild taste, excellent taste, and very popular in Japan as a vegetable, but for some reason has never been on. That knowledge has never come to Europe, despite interest in Asiatic vegetables over the last 30 years or so. Also, the flower shoots are nice and edible, and the flowers too are perfect. And this is Prince Charles's forest garden in London. He didn't know it at the time, but he has the national collection in the UK of large-leaved hostas. I wrote to him and told him about the fact he had a ready-made forest garden, but he hasn't answered yet. I know he's very interested in organic things, so I thought maybe there was a chance he would pick up on this. We're almost finished. Just a couple of dishes. Sorry?
You're wonderful.
Thank you.
Well, I'm enjoying it so much.
another one is, this is a couple of dishes which I've made from hosta. Hosta capita is, basically, I'm just using the hosta leaves like you would use spinach in a spanakopita, the Greek spinach pie. And we've also found a sushi recipe on the net and made sushi from hosta leaves. So these are all vegetables you could easily grow here in Mosjøen. Another one which is actually one of the blacklisted plants in Norway, which is a fantastic spring vegetable, is the slirikene, or Japanese knotweed, also a huge problem plant in the UK. You just eat it rather than trying to beat it. And it's the young shoots you use in the springtime. If you cook it up, you can use it like you would use rhubarb, in a rhubarb pie or something like that. You could also use it as a vegetable in stir-fry dishes. The plant is full of antioxidants, like many of the Sami vegetables. In fact, they grow Japanese knotweed in the Far East to extract an antioxidant, which is also found in red wine. So if you have red wine, and this red wine is a good accompaniment to this plant, okay? Yeah. Almost finished. And then daylilies, which is one of the oldest vegetables in the world, from China. There are huge areas of agricultural land which are put down to daylily production. They use mainly the flower shoots, and actually the flowers after daylily flowers, they last a day, and then they wither and die. They collect the flowers after they've withered. So you can have the flowers and collect the product, which is used as a kind of a spice in soups winter's time, in the winter. And this is at the Botanical Gardens in Oslo, where they've put out some snacks by the benches. Just finally, if I can take one more, is that right? Okay, yeah. Yeah. Probably the most used wild foraged plant in the Northern Hemisphere are the hogweeds, or the bjørneskjeks. When I moved to Norway in the early 80s, I bought Roger Phillips' wonderful book, Wild Food, from the UK, and he talked about schust bjørneskjeks, common hogweed, The one that grows up here is Sibir Bjørnesjøks. And he writes that this is unequivocally one of the best vegetables I've eaten, and hogweed shoots will surprise even the most conservative of your friends. In Norwegian foraging books, it said that it was poisonous. I couldn't quite understand this. I thought, you know, maybe it has to do with the long days up here. You know, there's something there. And I confused a bit the fact that hogweeds and many other plants in the umbellifer or the charmplante familia, they can burn you severely if you get the plant juices on you in strong sunlight. I sent a question to the Nutivexforening, the Useful Plant Society, and asked them their opinion on whether this was poisonous or not. They sent my inquiry to a professor at Aarhus, and he replied, "Don't touch it, this is poisonous." So he advised me strongly against it. Over the last 20 years, I've looked at this plant in all cultures around the globe, and in all cultures apart from Scandinavia, this was one of the best and most used forage plant from nature. It's also a very productive plant. The young shoots are used. Borscht. You know what borscht is? The beetroot soup. Borscht actually means hogweed, because before beetroot became available for a couple of hundred years ago, this plant that was used in that soup. Then one day I had a garden. I had people around in my garden to look at the plants, and an Iranian woman turned up. And she saw that I was growing various hogweeds, and she said, "Wow, that's really, we use that in Iran. This is really, really interesting." And in fact, you probably know that you all know about Tromsø palmer, okay? And it turns out that Tromsø palmer quite recently has been identified as Heraclium persicum. Persicum has to do with Iran. The plant she knew from her home place was actually Tromsø palmer, which they used the spring shoots of, and in particular they used the seeds, which they harvested in the autumn. And she told us that she harvested seed of Tromsø palmer from Trondheim, where it's gone wild, in the autumn, and they use it as a spice in the same way that you use cumin and other umbellifers or charmplante. Right enough, I went into a Persian shop in Trondheim, and they were selling Tromsø palmer seed as a spice. Amazing, you know, this plant is actually a huge plant, which is like giant hogweed, and I'm sure giant hogweed can be used in exactly the same way, because they're very, very close botanically. So it was all rather exciting. Struthering, we talked about it for this area here. Ostrich fern or struthering is probably the biggest food resource that you have in nature. But nobody on the foraging group I led this morning had ever tasted it. It grows in enormous amounts along the rivers. I've seen it as I arrived here. In North America, they harvest something like 1,000 tons of this plant in every springtime. Whereas in Norway, there's no tradition at all. Very strange, actually. And particularly in northern Norway, there is huge amounts of this plant. If you know of the Sami, if there's any Sami tradition of this, I'd be very interested to hear, but I've not managed to find anything out about it. Okay? Yeah. But it's the young fiddleheads, which are cut very early in the spring and cooked. One should cook them for about 15 minutes or so, because not because the fern is poisonous, and only use the fiddleheads of this fern. Be absolutely certain that it is this plant. If you're not certain, I brought with me some leaves, and we can talk about that later. Okay, talk about now if you like. Yeah.
What I've decided is that we're not going to do questions with Stephen.
No.
We're going to go for coffee afterwards, and then you can just go and ask him personally.
Yeah. So what's special about Strutsiving is that it has two types of leaf. It has these, it's already beginning to, we collected this yesterday. It has these tall, very green leaves in the summer. It's dried out a bit here, but it can be as high as me in very good conditions. It grows, it spreads vegetatively with rhizomes under the surface and can cover very large areas. But it's often just the same plant that looks like many plants. These tall summer leaves, which are the ones you see in the summer, they don't have any spores behind the leaves. If you look behind the leaves, they're just there's nothing there, unlike other ferns. The spores are found on these short, much shorter leaves, which you find right down low, and these are covered in spores, and they stand like erect like that the whole winter. So if you go to a place where there's Strutsiving, you'll find these fertile leaves the whole winter, and the spores are then spread in the early spring when the spring floods. So it's an effective way of spreading the plant. But it's springtime, one uses that. Also a fantastic ornamental plant. It's grown throughout Europe as a woodland, in woodland gardens. You see it in practically all botanical gardens. But it's in particularly in, it's not found in the UK, for example. It's only found in Scandinavia and northerly areas. So this is a real Arctic vegetable. And back to where we started. This is the prairie onion from North America. Because it's so widespread, there are many different forms, many different colour forms, and again, the combination of food and beauty is something that I particularly like. It shouldn't have been there, but and that was it, basically. This is this world salad I made in 2003. Thank you. Yeah.